My name's Michelle Garrett, and I'm Professor of Cancer Therapeutics here in the School of Biosciences at the University of Kent. And today I'd like to talk to you about cancer research, and in particular about how collaboration between industry and academia is changing the face of cancer treatment. So, new data shows that 1 in 2 people born after 1960 in the UK will get some form of cancer during their lifetime. Now, why is that? Well, each person's risk of getting cancer depends on many factors, including their age, their lifestyle, and also what they inherit from their parents, so their genetics. But one thing is clear from also from the new data is that 4 in 10 cancer cases could be prevented by lifestyle changes, such as not smoking, cutting back on alcohol, maintaining a healthy body weight, and avoiding such things as exposure to UV sunlight. But cancer is primarily a disease of old age. 53% of all cancers that are diagnosed are in adults between the age of 50 and 74. 36% of all cancers that are diagnosed are in adults aged 75 or older. Life expectancy in the UK is increasing with more elderly people alive today than ever. So to put this in context, in 1901, life expectancy at birth in the UK was 45 years for men and 49 years for women. Research in 2010 now shows us that life expectancy at birth in the UK is 78.1 years for men and 82.1 years for women. I've been involved in cancer research for nearly 30 years, and one of the questions that many people ask me is, what is cancer? Well, it's a disease caused when normal cells in the body change so that they grow in an uncontrolled way. And the uncontrolled growth can cause a lump, which is often referred to as a tumour. And if not treated, that tumour can cause problems in one of more ways, including spreading into normal tissues nearby, causing pressure on other body structures, spreading to other parts of the body through the bloodstream, and this can cause damage to other parts of your body, which can lead to illness and possibly death. There are also 200 different types of cancer. Now, why is that? This is because there are over 200 different types of cells in the human body. So we have, for example, muscle cells, liver cells, cells that are specific for the heart. And how do we treat cancer? Well, if it's caught and detected early enough, then we can treat it with surgery. Often treatment can also include radiotherapy and also cancer drugs, and this is what my talk will focus on today. So many of you will have heard the term chemotherapy. So this is a type of cancer drug that has been very effective in the past for cancer treatment and even now for certain forms of cancer treatment. But often these chemotherapies can have side effects that can include nausea and vomiting and also hair loss. Now, why is that? Well, this is because many of these chemotherapies are actually inhibiting growth and proliferation of cells in the body. So cells that are growing, dividing fast. And this can not only include the cancer cells, this may also be certain types of normal cells, such as your hair follicles and also the cells of your gut epithelia. But cancer treatment is changing. And this is through research. And through research, we now understand more about the difference between normal cells and cancer cells. So, what are cells? Well, cells are very important. They are the building blocks of the human body. And they make up the tissues and organs of our body. And as I said, there's more than 200 types of human cells in the body. Each cell has a wall around it called the cell membrane. And in the centre of the cell is the cell nucleus. And this contains the DNA, which is our genetic information. And this is usually coiled tightly to form chromosomes. And the DNA contains coded messages. And these messages, known as genes, provide the instructions to make the proteins, which are the building blocks of our cells and of our human body. And some proteins act as signals that tell the cell when to grow and divide. And I'm going to talk about one of these in a minute. So through research, we now understand that cancer is caused by faults in our DNA, that's mutations, gene mutations, and these can lead to proteins production of proteins that are deregulated. They may be overexpressed, so more of them, or they may be altered, so they're switched on when they shouldn't be. And so it's now possible to target these deregulated proteins in cancer cells. So these are new targets for cancer drug discovery. So cancer treatment now and moving forward not just includes surgery, radiotherapy, and chemotherapy, but we also have new molecular targeted drugs being discovered and developed. And these come in two forms: small molecules, which I'm going to talk about, and also biotherapeutics. An example of this is antibodies. And you can hear more about antibodies as treatments for cancer in Dan Lloyd's Think Kent talk. But now I'm going to focus on small molecules. But before I do that, I just want to address the question, who is involved in cancer drug discovery and development? Well, as you can suspect, large pharma, so large pharmaceutical companies, but it's not just them. It's also small biotech companies and also universities like the University of Kent. And also, we require funding for this, and this comes from a number of types of funding organisations, including government funding bodies and also charities that are involved in funding cancer research and drug discovery. And importantly, we mustn't forget the hospitals, because this is where these drugs are put into clinical trial. So all these types of organisations are important for cancer drug discovery and development. And how do we discover new cancer drugs? Well, it requires different types of researchers working together. So both biologists and chemists, and also clinicians in the hospitals. Because we need the researchers, the biologists, to discover the new cancer targets or the proteins that are deregulated in cancer. And then we need biologists and chemists working together to develop the new cancer drugs. And when we screen compound libraries to identify new cancer compounds, what we find is that in general, the compounds that we identified will not be the final cancer drug, and that they will need modifying and to make them more potent and selective towards the protein that we're targeting in the cancer cell. And this will require interaction between both chemists and biologists working together. So this is a very interdisciplinary activity, a team activity. And once we've identified a molecule that we can put into clinical trial, it also requires interaction with clinicians. So as I've said, a very team-driven activity, multidisciplinary. And now I'm going to just give you one example of this that involves a protein that I'm interested in called AKT and how we've developed a drug to treat breast cancer. So AKT is a protein found in the cell, and it is involved in signaling that drives cell proliferation, so telling the cell when to grow and divide. And what we know is that it can be found overactivated in certain forms of cancer, including breast cancer, ovarian cancer, and prostate cancer. And so a drug discovery program was initiated involving a number of organizations that I was also involved in. An academic organisation, the Institute of Cancer Research in London, Astex Pharmaceuticals, a biotech company, and also CRT, which is Cancer Research Technology, or the commercial arm of CRUK. And together, we identified a number of molecules that targeted AKT, and then AstraZeneca took these forward, and from this identified the final drug candidate, which was AZD5363, and is shown here on the right-hand side. And AstraZeneca have now put this into clinical trial, and it's in trial worldwide for breast cancer. And actually, two of the clinical trial sites are here in Kent, and these are the Kent Oncology Centre and East Kent Hospitals. So on this slide, I just show an example of a patient who's been treated with AZD5363. So this is an Asian female who'd had a number of previous lines of chemotherapy and who was identified as having a mutation in AKT such that she had deregulated AKT activity in her tumour cells. She was given the drug, and as we can see here on the left-hand side, you can see her endometrioid cancer of the ovary, and she had two lesions as shown. And you can see that after treatment, there is a significant decrease in her tumour size and in both of these lesions, showing how effective AZD5363 can be. But science doesn't stop there. There are ongoing questions that we want to ask in the lab, and these include research that's ongoing in my lab, such as, can we predict the mechanisms of resistance that we may see with these cancer drugs? Because like antibiotics, you can get resistance to cancer drugs and then patients will relapse. We want to identify ways to overcome this resistance, and through this research, potentially identify new drug targets. All this together for patient benefit. And what's the future of cancer research? Well, we need new cancer treatments, but we need to learn now how to also prevent cancer and also how we can detect cancer earlier. So for prevention, perhaps new cancer vaccines, we're already seeing some of these, such as for cervical cancer. Perhaps changes in our lifestyles will help prevent cancer. Better detection, better screening methods, such as in the future, perhaps silicon chips that will be under our skin and will be able to detect changes in our blood. And also looking far into the future, nanosurgery to actually change our DNA. But all this is going to need new cancer researchers, so the next generation of cancer researchers. And here at Kent, I don't just have a research lab, I'm involved in teaching both undergraduates and master students. And I think it's very important that we educate and develop the next generation of cancer researchers. And with that, I'll stop there and thank you for your attention.